microphone chair. So for those who I haven't met yet, I'm Janet Dymond. I'm the new director of the Woodstock Library. This is the first and what I hope to be a series of programs that are of general interest to the community. This one obviously in particular is on architecture in the town center. It's part of the Chamber of Commerce event and will obviously offer more programs. One of the things I'd like is to get your input, so you'll see a program evaluation about, you know, and you can suggest other programs for the series that will carry on as we go forward throughout the year and into the next year. So, I also want to give a special thanks to Jill Fisher and Dorothea Marcus, who really helped me out a great deal in organizing this event. So they're both library trustees, if you don't know, and have been a tremendous help to this particular event. So I'm just going to jump right into introducing the panelists so we can start the discussion. So many of you probably know more than I do. Sean Delisio, he has lived in Woodstock for most of his life. Okay. He's a second generation builder and is the principal of Greenland Building, a design build firm here in Woodstock. He has a bachelor's of architecture and a master's in architecture, and he is an expert, obviously, in architecture. David Eckroff, next individual. He's a registered architect with the New Paltz firm Alcondre Architecture. He's worked in, prior to that, he worked in Texas for 25 years as an architect and a professor at Texas A&M College of Design. He holds a Bachelor of Architecture from the University of Minnesota and a Master of Architecture from the University of Pennsylvania. David has served on the Town of Woodstock's Commission for Civic Design for over 12 years and has chaired it for the last 8 years. Jennifer Schwartz-Berkey is a native of New York City. She has worked with numerous communities and organizations to plan and implement projects affecting historic sites and neighborhoods. Prior to this, she was a cultural heritage specialist and planner at the World Bank. She holds a BA in art history from SUNY Stony Brook and master's degrees in urban planning and real estate development. She's also the principal with Home Strategic in Kingston and was just elected to the Ulster County Legislature to represent District 7 of Kingston. Our moderator tonight has graciously volunteered his time. Neil Larson, he's an architectural historian and a scholar of vernacular architecture who has lent his expertise to the Woodstock Berkeley Guild and the Maverick Concert Hall. He earned a bachelor's degree from Vassar College and a master's degree in American Material Cultural Studies from the University of Delaware. He's been working in the Hudson Valley for 30 years, and for the past 15, he has headed his own consulting firm, Larson Fisher Associates, based here in Woodstock. So I'd like to thank all the panelists and the moderators for volunteering their time, and I hope to have a lively discussion tonight. Come on, you.
Thank you, Janet. We're going to try to keep our volume level high enough so you all can hear. We had a little snafu with the microphones this afternoon, so we're winging it. So you all have to stay very quiet. And if any of us kind of start mumbling off, I'm sure you will remind us that you can't hear us. I thought I'd start off tonight before we got into the questions by setting a little bit of context for where we're at here in Woodstock and provide a kind of brief history of some of the periods of development here in the town center. Woodstock was settled right after the Revolutionary War. Like other new Catskill towns, the economy focused on forest products, stone, quarrying, mills, tanneries, and to a lesser degree, agriculture. The hamlet grew and evolved around road intersections, mills, stores, churches, and schools. And farms stretched out into the valleys beyond the outskirts of the hamlet. The second major phase in Woodstock's history came in the early 19th century, summer tourism. Woodstock became a destination, like a lot of Catskill towns, for summer tourism. The first tourists came via the river and then later by rail. Woodstock's proximity to the Hudson River here at the southeast edge of the Catskills made for easy access when compared to places deeper in the mountains. First attracted sportsmen and outdoor enthusiasts. The late lamented Meads Mountain House was one of the places that developed in this period. When the railroad arrived after the Civil War with a stop in West Hurley, the station's here in Woodstock, by the way, it brought thousands of summer vacationers into the region. Many hotels and boarding houses developed around Woodstock, Overlook being one of them. During this period, the hamlet commerce expanded to cater to tourists and growing service population. Then, in the early 20th century, there was the artist invasion. And this is where Woodstock took off in a unique direction compared to innumerable other Catskill resort towns. Birdcliffe started the transformation in 1902. Ralph Radcliffe Whitehead reputedly employed every man in town to build the colony. Because of Birdcliffe, the New York Art Students League established a summer school here in Woodstock a few years later. Their studio is right across the street where the Christian Science Meeting House is. And with the Art Students League Summer School, Woodstock was overrun with young artists. More than 100 came each summer. They boarded everywhere in the town and in the woods. Woodstock quickly became known as an art colony in a class of other renowned colonies along the Atlantic coast. Herbie White created an alternative maverick art colony in 1905, adding more working artists to the mix, and he introduced festivals to the town, which would be important later. As Alf Evers once told me, during this time, if a hat was blown off the head of a motorist driving down the road, before he could turn around to retrieve it, some artist would have added a skylight and made it into a studio. The hamlet became the central place for permanent and transient artists. Institutions were created, such as WAM and the library. Between the World Wars, Woodstock experienced summer cottage development. These were people coming up from the city for summer places now facilitated by the automobile. Many had artistic sensibilities, many with progressive and radical or red backgrounds. The hamlet was the center of a bristling intellectual community. The hamlet expanded out in every direction. Houses closest to the center were adapted to commercial use. After the Second World War, significant events happened that shaped our town center. IBM in Kingston brought new residential development to Woodstock and the surrounding towns. Engineers and artists living together. Albert Grossman brought rock and rollers to town. Like Dylan at Newport in 1965, Woodstock goes electric. Sound outs and the 1969 festival that was never here. And the hippie nation. And Woodstock became known as the most famous small town in the world. And the town center as an international cultural attraction, a festival center with films, poets, writers, luthiers, tattoos. Small is beautiful. Protecting the center and the town from development became a dominant issue. So each of these areas of development have left their imprint on the town center and its architecture, which brings us to our panel discussion this evening. And I want to begin with the following question for our panelists. What are the architectural and landscape features that make Woodstock's town center unique or special? Jump right in.
I think that Woodstock, the topography and the geography of Woodstock are more unique than the architectural qualities that it has. I think the relationship of the buildings to the topography and the geography actually kind of dominate the way we interact with the town more so than our neighboring towns in Kingston and Saugerties. I think that kind of is what sets a precedent for the concern of this discussion, I think, in my opinion.
Well, Can you hear me?
No.
No.
Jerry. Well, the town is structured, fortunately, faces south, which gives it good light, especially sunlight, obviously. But I think the center of the town is the village green, and from that you've got the streets, Rock City, Tinker Street, Mill Hill, up and down the street, old residential buildings and old shops that were converted over the last 20, 30 years into commercial use. So there's been a transformation of some of these wonderful old buildings. Old wood frame buildings are pretty well built in the day that were transformed into commercial. Without the commercial shops and use, there wouldn't be much here because it's a largely a tourist town as well as a town for 8,000 people. But I think the village green is kind of the hole in the donut here that we tend to know about and we focus on. And if you go up the mountain hiking and look down, it's the church steeple that points you right in that direction. So it's both looking outward from the point of view, the architecture of that church, Dutch Reformed Church. And you can sense where you are, no matter where you are up in the mountains. So the town has visual outreach for miles, and then it has its intricacies as we walk up and down the street. But I disagree with Sean a little bit. I think there are a lot of good buildings in Woodstock. Some need attention, some have gotten attention. Some are in disrepair, especially if you get off Tinker and Mill Hill, if you get off a block or two. In some areas, some of the old homes are deteriorated, but that's not what we see a lot of. But I tend to like the town because it's, every time I come in, I meet people, and it's easy to communicate with people. You go into the hardware store, and there's somebody there, you know. So culturally and socially, connected with the architecture of the small scale, two-story buildings, some with basements, some not, the scale of it and the materials and overall the colors and so forth and the porches and so forth lends to a very rich environment. Granted, the economy is not super. It's not like Rhinebeck. It doesn't have the money in that sense behind it. However, there's still a lot to be said for the town.
Let's let Jennifer pick up.
Actually, I would pick up from where David was just going, which is my experience of Woodstock is I don't live here, first of all. So when I visit here, I take in more the experience of place. And being, having worked, in fact, with a lot of communities in Ulster County, what I observe about here is that the rhythm of the buildings as they as an ensemble is what strikes me as the most characteristic, whether they're significant or whether they're, significant or just vernacular. I think the proximity that the buildings have to one another is unique for Woodstock. For example, if you visit Stone Ridge or Port Ewen, things are much more spread out and the scale is very different. So each community that we're in really expresses itself through the decisions that are made, and some of that is regulatory, some of it is design, some of it is just the community deciding how they want to live in proximity to one another. And in this case, you really have this rhythm of great proximity, which creates a scale of walkability and of comfort that I don't feel in a lot of the other communities around. So to me, that's, I mean, just adding to what you say, I think
so
what makes it
significant. Since we're talking about architecture here, are there architectural examples here that help characterize or define our unique place here? Is it simply the overall environmental feeling one gets walking down the street? Do we have landmarks that are?
Well, it's not, I mean, a lot of people think that it's a New England type village. I guess you could make that argument, right? Because of the appropriated farmhouses that have become or have remained in the village. But I think it's more of an eclectic. There isn't any one specific type of architecture. I don't think the architecture has necessarily evolved from a certain period, probably. But,
could you speak up a little
sure.
louder?
Yes, sorry about that.
Admittedly, my hearing isn't great,
okay.
But I do have hear what you're saying.
To me, what I described and what you said about the village square, to the village green, sorry, to me, that opening out and the creation of a kind of outdoor room is what is most defining about the public space, about the architecture here. It's more the architecture of place and space that creates an outdoor living room for the community, and to me, that's the most significant limb on the wall. But I know that there are probably some significant buildings that I've missed. What do you think?
Yeah. Well, the building we're in is significant in the sense that it's been transformed into this courtroom, police, dispatch, well, court, et cetera. But except that, you know, 10 years ago, this room was completely different than it is now. So it's an example of trying to maintain something and improve it. Rather tear it down and put it out in a big parking lot someplace where everybody has to drive to it. Because unfortunately, some of the places you have to walk to, fortunately, the library's close by, this building's close by. We don't have to go very far for the institutions. I wasn't here when the post office moved, but I can imagine the post office, which is like a community center in itself, across the street here, had to move down, so now people have to drive to it. And in the winter, it's not so great. Granted, they needed a bigger building and more parking. However, it was one of those adjustments made because of traffic and parking and servicing a post office that had moved. But normally in a town, we try and keep those institutions in the village as close as you can.
Used to.
All
right, let's move on here. So I outlined this bit of history for Woodstock. Can we or should we associate historic significance to any particular time or image for the town?
I think it's worth recognizing all the periods, from Birdcliff to the Woodstock Handmade House period to the Maverick and to the prior farmhouses. I think all those deserve respect and consideration and shouldn't be overlooked. But at the same time, I don't think it should be limiting, and I don't think that we should be preserving everything as a finite set, unchangeable, evolutionary.
To me, even though you outlined a whole range of things that brought Woodstock about, what makes Woodstock probably most significant is its very creative spirit. So what that would mean in terms of preservation is actually maybe the opposite of what preservation means traditionally. And we had some of these discussions when we were meeting beforehand. It was very lively. Because historic preservation tends to say, let's pick a time frame and let's freeze that, or at least take a period of significance and say, that's the way we should continue to build, which to me, as a historic preservation, is a sort of an irony, because we may in fact lose the very thing that we're trying to protect, which is a sense of creativity, a sense of energy moving forward. So to me, creativity is the time that we should preserve, whatever that means.
I might mention that in the zoning law of the town of Woodstock, there's the Hamlet Preservation Overlay District and the Gateway District. Those are recognized in town law. So there's obviously an acknowledgement of the historic nature of the town. So if you go to the golf course all the way up Mill Hill, up Rock City Road a short distance, and down Tinker Street to getting the street to where that purple house is. To that point, all the properties along there are in that historic preservation overlay district. Now, what does that mean? It means that if a project comes up, it can be residential. If a project comes up to the planning board and or zoning board, it could get referred to the civic design to look at it relative to what the owner wants to do with the building in that district, because the district has some guidelines to it. They're not like Nantucket, but there are guidelines about trying to maintain the quality of that building. Again, it has to be recognized as having some quality. So those districts, in fact, have a bit of governing or a bit of, I should say, bite to them.
This leads me to our next question. A lot of towns in the region are looking towards historic rehabilitation to help revitalize ailing commercial centers. as one of the more thriving centers around, does Woodstock need to do this?
I think that the zoning laws that were written in the 80s did just that, in a way that it preserved, I don't necessarily think that it revitalized, but...
I don't mean so much preservation, but right. Rehabilitation. Well,
how does that work? How does the preservation revitalize normally in the towns that you're referring
to? Well, this would be taking certain underutilized or altered buildings and rehabilitating them to function more cohesively in a in a district setting, or to function more effectively to attract business.
So,
but focusing on the historic value, the architecture of the buildings, to essentially restore aspects of them so that.
Well, I think that, a lot of communities thought that meant demolishing buildings for a period of time. That the only way they could move forward was to,
We're past that now.
Yes, so we're past that. But now a lot of communities seem to think that the history is the greatest generator of economic activity, at least for tourism. And in Ulster County, we have, that's one of the number one drivers of tourism, is cultural heritage tourism. Although I am concerned about the idea that we should, that should make us in some way try to create something for the visitor that isn't authentic about the community. And again, this is where we get to the question of, is economic development going to be about giving the visitor what they expect to experience about our place? Or are we going to be who we are and what expresses us and allow that to generate what we do and that therefore be an attractor for the economy? And I would prefer the latter. So I don't know how you regulate that, but I think that there are examples of it which we can talk about later. We're going to talk about that a little bit later, that I bring from Kingston, for example.
Jay, we're not taking questions.
Neil, your questions and statements are very loud and clear, and most of your colleagues on the board are talking to you,
right?
Rather than to us.
Okay, good sorry point. About that.
And please talk to us, because that's okay. Why I'm here.
Raise your hand if you can't hear while we're speaking. We'll just...
As a side note, I need to mention. Richard Heppner over here is our town historian. I'm sure most of you know him. And some years ago, he made a valiant effort to develop a historic registry for the town of Woodstock based upon state guidelines. And it's a double-edged sword, because what that means, if I'm a property owner of a nice old building and I put it on the register, I get into historic preservation and restoration, not renovation. And it has much stricter guidelines about what you can do and what you can't do.
Forgive me, but that's not true.
Oh.
And therein lies the problem.
But let me finish. The issue was, when if somebody wanted looked into applying for a registry, what that meant was that the next owner could not do all the modifications or changes to the building that they might want to do. So it's limited.
You're talking about the national registry?
No, I'm talking about the local, an attempt at a local registry based upon state of New York registry standards. Richard can talk more about that.
So you're talking about a local?
Local.
Yeah. Local designation. Okay.
Local designation, not federal.
You're right. They provide certain...
And what happens with some of these buildings, as we all know, and they turn commercial on the ground floor, which is on a porch, first thing you have to do is put a ramp to it. And you could go up and down the street and look at those ramps and the lighting and the signage and all of that stuff, and it puts a whole different level of visual acknowledgement to the building.
Okay, coming at this from another angle, some people say that the town center is looking messy, even schlocky. This affects how the architecture is presented. Should something be done to maintain the visual integrity of buildings, or will this affect the commercial viability and tourist attraction of the businesses?
I just wanted to, being spontaneous as we were during our discussion in the back room of the library, we had a really lively discussion. And what you just said, David, before we get to your next question, what you just said, we experience that all the time in Kingston, where there are some very strict rules. And I'm sorry to bring in examples of Kingston, but that's where I live. And I think a lot of you know Kingston, right? Mm-hmm. So we can relate to the idea that, well, what do you do with strict guidelines, which we do have, when you need to adapt a building? For example, in Uptown Kingston, we have a very beautiful building, which, by the way, would not have been built if we had very strict rules in 1920. Because it was a car showroom, and it's a very beautiful building on North Front Street, which is now called the Senate Garage. But 2 months ago, they brought the ramp to the Landmarks Commission for us to review among the Landmarks Commission in Kingston, and we had a very tough time because the rules for Uptown Kingston would have historicized that and would have prevented us from allowing them to do it with the scoring in the sidewalk, which is from 1920s, and the more modern style of that building, and we would have ended up with something anachronistic. But we were able, as a group, as a Landmarks Commission, to be flexible enough to say, this is how we interpret the guidelines to meet that the significance of that particular building, and not rub out what that means. So I think when people perceive that a Landmarks Commission for local guidelines is going to somehow prevent the proper adaptation of a building, I think that's when you have a Landmarks Commission that isn't comfortable with its power to make important decisions about design. So what I'm saying is you can have a good conversation about that. You can have a good conversation about design, and you don't end up having to be slavish to the past. So.
On the topic of the question of the village green, I think it used to be somewhat schlocky when there was grass out there that turned to mud and they had the orange plastic fences to keep it. Well, now I think it's great. You've got a stone surface that can be used for many different things, music or those drum guys or whatever. And the lighting is not great, can be improved, but there's vegetation, the gardening people maintain that. Bless their hearts for doing that. There's great buildings around. The Village Green B&B is one of the best buildings in Woodstock. And other small one-story, two-story buildings housed. And up and down the street there, I think it's a good definer of the green. And I think the green, I don't find the green very schlocky. What I do find schlocky are tons of overhead power lines, people tacking notices on telephone poles, sandwich boards, which by law are not allowed, people use them anyway. And there's a number of other small pieces here and there, but overhead power lines I find incredibly, as much as we need the power. And Central Hudson says it's too expensive to put them underground, which is debatable. But anyway, I find that to be more of a problem than the buildings themselves or the town center.
I think that Woodstock has been in and out of its disrepair for a long time. I mean, there were periods in the 80s where Woodstock, no one could go through town and say it wasn't seedy looking. But I think it comes and goes with the ebb and flow. But I do think that as far as the aesthetics of the village, it's important to note that the charm of the village comes from everything above Joyous Lake right through to the Tinker Street Cinema. And I think that has a lot to do with the fact that everything below Joyous Lake, the parking is in the front of the business, and everything above Joyous Lake, the parking is off street behind tucked in little parking spots. So you get a better appreciation and relationship to the architecture of the village.
Are you saying
too different? But that, I don't know if that has anything to do with the wear and tear of the town, but I think that has a lot to do with the aesthetics. And it's something that should be kept into consideration as we move forward with new laws and regulations or changes or adaptions. So
are you saying that the terrible gateway is what makes you appreciate the rest of the...
Yeah, well, the gateway's the gain of the gateway. I ever said if it wasn't for the golf course, no one would know there was a were mountains in town. So there is a reason to preserve the gateway, but at the same time, there's a limitation as to what, you know, as we evolve forward, what can and can't be done. We had that big fight with the current owners of the restaurant there, so I think those kind of limitations get a little excessive, in my own opinion.
Yeah, the red barn at the gateway is a like a monumental figure. People remember that, the barn, Kuchin and so forth. What they don't remember is a sign farm, which is right down there. And that's just a continual mess. I think it's a visual clutter. Too many signs jammed up on private and public property. And that's not a real welcome to Woodstock. I think the welcome is the mountains, and like John said, the golf course, the openness. As you come into that, that is also a gateway on the other side of town. But the primary one, 375 and 212, could use some visual cleaning up, I believe. How to enforce that, I'm not sure. I mean, there are laws about the size of signs. Enforcement is an issue.
Might the Chamber of Commerce disagree? I mean, signage and markings are important for the tourists that come in and help the economy thrive.
Signage is important, and it depends upon how it's done. The state of New York has got a pamphlet, a booklet that they put out some years ago about appropriate and inappropriate signage. And if anybody read through that, you'd really be disgusted with what you see down there, because there are ways to do beautiful signs, and a lot of shops in town have very nice custom signs that are smaller than the maximum area, that are well lit with shielded lighting and all that. And there are other places that they just don't care about signage. So I think that's a mixed bag. I mean, it's a tough one, because if it was enforced exactly the way the law is written, much of the signage you see up and down the street would not exist.
And that would be a good thing.
I think it would be a good thing, and I don't think it would harm the commercial aspect of the town at all. I think it's just a question of the owner biting the bullet and doing a better sign.
Just to add some information, the Chamber of Commerce has no control over that array of signs there. It's not within the purview of the Chamber of Commerce. It's a private sign arrangement. Yeah. I believe Chester Perchick from Upstate Signs runs it on the property there. So it's not a Chamber of Commerce. Actually, we've had conversations about trying to make it look better, but it's not again, our responsibility.
You have a sign ordinance, though, right?
Yeah.
It was a sign ordinance
in Woodstock,
right?
Well,
you want to show that as an example?
Should I relate that to the next question? Are we doing that now?
Well, not
really. We're almost
she's
there.
She's queuing right. Us, right?
Let's,
One other note on stalkingness. One thing, another area that could be improved are the pathways from the rear parking lots to Tinker and Mill Hill. Mm-hmm. You go over to the Mountain View parking lot or house, and you walk to Tinker Street. Some of the pathways are pretty good. They're not muddy. They've got decent lighting at night and so forth. And other pathways are hazards.
So I just wanted to give an example of that. I don't know that's actually, I don't know how we got onto that, but the reason I bring this up is because I love the idea that every single interstitial space, every single negative space,
or I guess you could say,
residual space, right, in a community is one of a missed opportunity. In this case, where you have the walk from the parking to the street, you brought up IBM. Okay, this community doesn't. It doesn't feel like it has that same response to the sort of modern experience of IBM. But in Kingston, and I'm sorry again to bring up Kingston, but just as a good example that I think could translate over here, we had some we had some exuberance, some excitement over IBM in the 50s that resulted in some good and some bad new buildings. But there were a couple of examples that were very interesting and I think have actually improved the experience in Uptown. One of them is the Citizens Bank. There's a space between Citizens Bank and Key Bank where you walk through a little tunnel as you walk out of the parking lot, and then suddenly what you get is this experience of this old Dutch church framed by the space between the buildings. Now, if you were to take the exercise of walking in between buildings in Woodstock and say, what do I see when I get out to the street? How could that be framed, even if it's just landscaping or some other kind of...
Or a mural.
A mural or a more temporary architectural treatment. You could find some very interesting, a different scale, of course, but some very interesting opportunities right here in Woodstock. So, I just wanted to share that example with you.
Okay.
But parking, to answer your question, I think parking is a very significant 21st century or 20th century issue that needs to be re-examined in every community as it affects the experience of our spaces. So,
I understand the planning board is doing that as one of their tasks, is to look at parking in Woodstock. Where it is, how much there is, how people move from here to there. I don't know what the status of that is right now, but I know it's one of their tasks.
In process.
So, I guess somewhat following on this, what Jennifer just last said about adapting to our time, now that Woodstock is a 21st century place, what can be done that's responsive to our own time? Woodstock has staked its reputation on being progressive, artistic, unconventional, and non-historical. How do we nurture that?
Well, I think right now we're not progressive. We are conservative. We are conventional. We're not open to change. We're not open to the new growth. We're not open to... We have too many rules and regulations. I think by default, we just keep, as a society, if that's the default setting, you just keep adding more rules and restrictions, thinking that you're going to make it better. More signage, more lighting, more pedestrian, or, you know, more controls on the type of building. Trying to preserve something that may or may not be worth preserving, and not allowing, like, the former generations that were allowed to create great masterpieces, to create Birdcliff, to do... There were no regulations when they came and did Birdcliff. There were no regulations when they went and did Maverick. And I'm afraid eventually we're just going to become a museum of a town where we're going to have, you know, over here this happened and over here this happened back then, but what's happening now? And I think there's a possibility by the default, by not being progressive-minded or open to, you know, what are we preserving? That's the big thing in my mind. What are we trying to protect? What has been done in the past that we really need to preserve here? And by preserving it, what are we not allowing to happen in the future? And I think that's a big problem in Woodstock, because Woodstock is a very finite, small, contained environment that is almost fully saturated. There is not much room to grow. The town does not have a lot of room to grow. There's very few sites to make change. Right? I mean, find a spot in town besides the house parking lot, which I think would be a fantastic place in the future to do a 3 or 4 day a week like they're doing the farmer's market, a piazza. There's all those buildings in there. That's a potential future place to grow into a little pedestrian pocket. But other than that, the town has limitations on height, has limitations on property saturation on the building site. So those are my concerns as to what's happening now, what's happened in the past, and where we're going to go.
I might refer to the Commission for Civic Design, because we're often accused of as being the design police. The fact is there's no public body in the town of Woodstock that regulates design. They won't hold up in the court of law. There are guidelines, and that pamphlet that you have on your seat, we mean a civic design group, put that together about 6 years ago. And I'll just want to read one paragraph, if I might. It says, on the building form and massing, which, and there are examples in here, design proposals are encouraged and reflect and enhance the historic character of the town and should not be generic boilerplate forms. And I'm going to show an example of that in a minute. A building or collection of buildings can follow a traditional style or be a modern interpretation and still respect Woodstock's small town fabric. So it's really, a lot of it is up to the designer, the owner and the designer. Some of the owners don't want to do anything except put a coat of paint on a building and maybe put a ramp up to the porch. other owners are willing, and I think it's going to may happen with the colony, for example, are willing to invest in the property to improve the exterior and the interior to bring it up. So everyone is kind of a case-by-case thing, because civic design has seen a lot of different projects. We only look at projects, non-residential projects, that are referred to us by the planning board or zoning board or town board. We don't go out and look for, find trouble. We review stuff that and try and work with the designer to make it better than what they brought in. That's the whole idea. But I think, getting back to Sean's comment, I think there is a lot of room for innovation, and I think it should happen. We're in the 21st century, and I think there's room to improve old buildings and do new buildings and respect the character and be very modern, energy efficient, and so forth, to reflect their culture at this time, rather than just be copies of the past.
Isn't it interesting that we had difficulty in the beginning of the questioning to define a historic character for the town center, and yet we base our guidelines and recommendations on a historic character,
right?
As if it exists. Is it the New England town?
It's the cumulative history of all of it that everybody relates to and appreciates. Like, we all have our thing in the past that we are inspired by, our multiple things that have happened that we want to protect and we don't want to change. And I think that when they rewrote the zoning laws in the 80s, I think that it did what it was supposed to do. I think that at the time they were afraid of, they wanted to protect the open green space. They wanted to keep the town from turning into a strip town with commercial stuff running all the way up to through the Bearsville Flats. And I think that those laws have served their purpose. But now all we're doing is continuing to add.
But that doesn't really address the civic design aspect of it. Right. Yes, the zoning has helped contain the center. And I guess limit it in terms of scale and stuff. But
it has been limited. I mean, in the last 30 years, I can't really see much change.
It seems
there hasn't really been much change in town. It's almost a few paint colors have changed. CVS, it used to be Grand Union. Wow, that's a big change. We got the monastery. Everybody thought that was going to make traffic lights at the Village Green. And we got the affordable housing down behind the Bradley Meadows. And the Playhouse Lane is going to come to a standstill. That never happened. I mean, we're afraid. We overanalyze everything in this town. And I think that, eventually we just keep that mindset just keeps growing, because we create panels and we create volunteer groups and we have, planning board and the zoning review and the CDC, and we want, as a body, you want to make regulations. Oh, look, we're analyzing, we need better walkways, so let's see, we got some more lights, we can get some more signs, but what does that actually do to the energy of the town? How does that improve the quality of the town by adding more restrictions? We want to, in my opinion, I've been waiting forever, we want to kick in the butt, we want to get going again, we want something to happen, we don't want to just watch it dilapidate.
Well, as a defender of good government, I would like to take a devil's advocate position. So I sit on a number of sort of governmental things, because I really believe government can actually be a force for good, as we were in the Niagara bottling situation, as some of our guests remember. This was another situation in which another history. But sitting on a landmarks commission, sitting, let's say, on the legislature or wherever I do, I don't think that the bodies can always be blamed for the conservatism that you talked about. I think that has more to do with, for what I'd like to see, is a change in the discussion of the role that government can play. You could, for example, the Landmarks Commission in Kingston was once a very conservative group. It doesn't have to be. Now it's a group that works with building owners and says, well, how can we work with you? Obviously, we want to preserve the historic character. We're not going to say, okay, dormers anywhere, solar panels anywhere, whatever, but we're going to work with the owner to make sure that the evolution of the building is still feasible within some of the confines. There are ways of working together. But I wanted to give an example, if that's okay. I know I'm jumping to your next question, but it's going back to the idea of how restrictive regulations have to be and what creativity can be, the murals. So you mentioned murals as an opportunity. How many of you are familiar with all the new murals that are going up in Uptown Kingston? So that was an example of the arrival of a generation of people who wanted to see a festival that responded to a great need in the community, artists and healthcare. So the O Positive Festival has been bringing these murals increasingly to Uptown Kingston, and the Friends of Historic Kingston became alarmed because they said, well, this is a historic district, you can't do this. So we as Landmarks Commission said, well, wait a minute, Savannah has murals, they're very historic, Philadelphia has murals, they're very historic, let's look at how they're dealing with it. And so we talked about the idea of it and not damaging the buildings, but at the same time not holding back the creativity that is the essence of the community as it's evolving. Maybe the community was one thing at one time, but right now what the community is a very vibrant place. So in a sense, we decided to be a progressive historic preservation board and decided to come up with a model or an adaptation of the regulations that would suit the purpose of allowing history to go forward. So that was just one example, but I think it's a good example of how government can be whatever you want it to be. It doesn't have to be just a restriction on the choices that you make. It can also be a force for progress. So.
Well, I think you guys have done a great job in Kingston.
Sorry?
I think you have done a great job in Kingston. Kingston is like a very exciting community right now. There's a lot of energy, a lot of positivity, a lot of people coming up from the city and rehabbing the old warehouses.
But I think that represents the zeitgeist in the community,
right,
that you that is, doesn't happen in a vacuum. It happens because you say, hey, we're willing to take a leadership role in making change.
I also feel that the people that are moving into Kingston and making those changes, the artists and so forth, don't feel restricted. They feel like, you know, this is a town that I can come, or a city, and do what I want to do and not be told no. So.
Now, you brought some slides. Do you want to speak to them? And you have had some shown. Do you want to?
Yeah, well, no, I only wanted to show them if it came up in conversation.
So okay.
If we get to it, then I'll show the other two.
Well,
the point I think you were making, though, is that it's really up to the civic body to get involved. If you're not happy with something on the street, or you don't see enough innovation, or modern work, or contemporary work, or whatever.
Or too much.
You go to town board meetings and make noise. I mean,
but you are the civic body.
Because the zoning law is not cast in stone forever. It has opportunity for amendment and improvement. But again, the zoning law does not dictate design.
But doesn't there also need to be some level of consensus before things are fought out in public hearings? We're revising our comp plan. Shouldn't there be more language in our?
Well, I wish we had a comp. I wish we had.
We're talking about the new one again. But it talks more about what we mean when we say historic character, or what we. How we approach change,
Well, the comp plan and the surveys that go up for it are a great vehicle, and as Jerry Washington and I both know, having sat on that 12-member committee for two or three years, the comp plan is a great vehicle for doing much of what we're talking about here, or at least encouraging innovation, improvement, and 21st century response in old or new buildings. So it's a great thing, but we don't have a comp plan. That's one of the dilemmas, and we're kind of, it's a tug of war between our individual ideas and having a document that supports the idea. Now, consensus, that, and you can get, how many voters are, 2,700 voters in Woodstock, or 8,000 residents plus, and the weekenders, and more younger people wanting to move to this area, which is an incentive, I think, to help push this forward, to do more and better work. So there are a number of factors, but consensus, I don't know how you reach consensus.
Well, you know, it's a very good point you raised, the comp plan. We 1961 was our last comp plan in Kingston, and a lot of communities in Ulster County have taken a long time to update them, and sometimes they really don't reflect the community will. In fact, I would argue that the one in Kingston doesn't necessarily completely reflect the vision. It depends on how you do the plan. But if it leaves enough room, I think, for the discussion of character to evolve, I think that's good. The last one we had allowed for urban renewal and the demolition of whole sections of the city. So, it's very loose. It's a problem more than a solution in some ways, but it's really important to have that because that does set the zoning for the future. So I think it's a great thing. I would advocate for it, and I think I stood up in a hearing here about 8 or 10 years ago to support you guys adopting one. I don't know where it's gone since then, but
Maybe I could talk about those three slides I have, if you can put those on, unless you have.
No,
I just wanted to show three examples here that have different approaches to what to do. We all know this guy, the Gill. Now, this came to civic design some years ago, and you find three interconnected buildings that have had various and sundry additions and improvements. And the concept of this, I'm going to stand up to point this out, the concept which is very, not avant-garde, but very interesting, is to take three buildings and try and visually tie them together with this ribbon of steel. Now, that may sound, it sounds pretty interesting as a theory, than as a reality of this thing, because when this came to civic design, this band was twice as high as it is here. And the question we had in front of us was not that the idea was terrible, it was that, is it a marquee or is it a sign? In other words, if the Gill started hanging banners on here that lasted longer than a day or two for the event, it's a sign. And a sign can't be over 10 square feet. And when you look at something 4 feet high and 50 feet long, you can add it up, that's 200 square feet of sign on Tinker Street. So it was a tug of war between trying to put an idea out that had merit, yet do it in such a way that they could actually get away with it, and not put banners out there that would stay out for weeks and weeks. And so they've kept it pretty clean, and there is decent lighting behind it and so forth. So it's an example, I think, of how to mitigate something that is a modern kind of thing, this ribbon across here. Did you go to the next one? This is what I'd rather not see anymore. The problem is obvious. Now, we know that it can be done better because up the street with the Woodstock garage up the street and mechanics, you have kind of a gable end colonial piece that sticks out. Cars used to go in and out of the gas station. And the garage part of it sat behind. But these fast food places, this could be any place. This could be in Northern California. This is one of those boilerplate generic buildings that does not say anything about Woodstock at all. It doesn't reinterpret, it doesn't do anything to advance the discussion about building design. It's just a functional place that's not very attractive. So of course, we don't like this. The way this is done, the colors and the lettering and all the stuff in the windows, that I'd call schlocky. It's probably historic now. Well, it's historic because it's open 24 hours. This was one, this project came to us, actually Brad Wood was involved with this. Old building turned into a tea house, right? But it came to us before this work was done, was a fairly ordinary two-story building. But the way the canopy, this metal canopy with the snow guards, a nice sign up here, which is a building-mounted sign. The door sitting the way the whole thing works, and adding another entrance around the corner. We worked with the owner and architect on this, and it didn't take very long, as I recall. And I think it turned out to be a very good project. So this is an example of what you can do as an old building, upgraded to more contemporary expression with contemporary materials. Now granted, they used metal even 100 years ago, but not quite like this. So I think this project, is, although it's a small building, is a good example of a good design change, a transformation of a fairly plain old building that's something much nicer.
That awning is an interesting example because a lot of preservation commissions, if you go to the guidelines in the National Trust, gives, they say awnings should not go to the edge of the building. They have incredibly detailed rules about things like awnings. They have a whole publication about awnings. And if you were in a historic district with all those guidelines, you would not end up with that very nice awning. So I think that's a really good example of where you need to leave room for what is, I think, a nice design idea without getting so stuck on, well, that's not how an awning would look in 1880.
Right.
So I'm a preservationist. Don't report me to the preservation police.
What do you think, Sean?
I think that how many more buildings like that in Woodstock can actually have that done to them? A handful? Six? I mean, Woodstock, like I said, is saturated. There really isn't that much more for restoration and or what is left. And then, like you said, the historic section is...
Aren't there a lot of buildings out there that are
not like
for a treatment like this?
Yeah. I don't think so.
Well, whether it's a treatment like this or a treatment like the ribbon, I think that there's an opportunity to think about what you could do to meet a challenge of the future. You asked about technology, the 21st century. One of the things that's doing is actually bringing more people into Woodstock. For example, Airbnb, whether you love it or not, is bringing so many new faces into town because we have a new sharing economy. So every time I go into Oriole 9, I see all these people I've never seen before, maybe because I don't come to Woodstock that often, but also because I think there's a lot of faces who are here for a night who wouldn't have been here for a night if this shared economy didn't exist. And so the idea of spaces acting differently simply because we have a new technology in the way that we convene could have an effect that we don't anticipate. But one of them might be, for example, how you notify people about things. So I'm not against banners. I just think you have to decide whether banners, like the idea of Christo and the disappearing moment in architecture, I don't think that there's anything wrong with a banner that announces something special if you can understand that maybe you don't want that to stay out for a month or forever, but that there are different moments that should be treated differently, and so maybe regulation has to address that, or maybe not, but the community has to talk about how it wants to address those changes. So. I'm sorry, I talked to him. Could you hear that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. You want to show him? Yeah.
Well, the only thing I wanted to mention is the most provocative question is not on our list anymore, but I really liked it, which is what happens if a building burns down? So this is Sean's bugaboo. There's no place to add. Although I do think all that parking lot stuff could be changed in the front of town, and what if those burn down? But if you go to the last slide, which was something from Toronto, which I was looking for examples of infill design, okay? I don't happen to love this one, but it was one of many examples. Toronto is a city that has a wonderful historic character, but also understands how to do infill. And so there's a whole website called Toronto Infill. And they have lots of houses that are show what an old house did when it added a wing, or what happened between two houses when you added another one. And I think it's really, to me, this community decided that was fine with them. Maybe another community would say, oh, you have to have eaves, or you have to have smaller windows, or you have to have articulation here and there. But to me, it's more a question of first of all, to me, it's more a question of scale, material, and maybe even something that it doesn't fight with the neighbors in a more European sense of what new design is, has a relationship with them, right? But it's for each community to decide how they want to see infill occur. But I'm curious to hear even what other people here think, and I know we're going to have a discussion, But what you guys think about, you know, what would a building look like if there was a space to build a new one?
Well, the annex.
Oh yeah, I forgot about
that. Is a classic, is the perfect example. It's not necessarily in context with the surrounding, and it is kind of an infill, but at the same time, it's a standalone building, so it's not necessarily competing like this. But that's the same scale, right? So in a way, I mean, do you like it? You know, I don't like the buildings on either side that much either. They're not necessarily fantastic buildings. So, I mean, architecturally, they're whatever. They're buildings, and they're not standout buildings. But I think the annex project was an opportunity in scale and in context. And it was also something that was going to be a motivating factor, I think, for growth, but just, you know, a little uplifting moment, a public building that, and the scale too. I also thought the scale was not offensive. It was small. I think people maybe saw some elevations that looked like it was bigger than it was. I think that was a missed opportunity, actually. And I think that in regards to new buildings in Woodstock in the last 15 years, the public buildings that we have had, they're insignificant. You know, they're not loving, inspiring, because the regulations and the fear of the designers, I think that if, you know, you feel like you end up with something that's mediocrity, right? I mean, you can't necessarily say the things that we've done in Woodstock in the last 10 years for the town are inspiring, grand, you know, civic pride type structures. They're just structures that are doing utilitarian functions.
I think generally the age of imposing civic architecture has passed.
Right, but there still can be a moment.
Just Woodstock.
You know, a Frank Gehry moment. The Fisher Center is a much more grandiose, but it's a jewel. You know, the little annex to me was like a little jewelry box of inspiration. So, and it was filled with light. It relates to the stream. I think that's a thing that Woodstock should reconsider too, is the relationship to the streams, because we asked in the beginning what are some of the most significant things about Woodstock, and I think I said topography and geography. And the streams are a major factor in this town. That the European towns relate to their streams. They're little. They have sidewalks and benches and stuff and steps down to the streams. And we tend to let it all the overgrowth and the weeds grow up, and then we're blocked off from our own relationship to the streams. So I think the fear of a 100-foot setback to a stream is a ridiculous concept. You know, I think. So there's multiple opportunities and. Making regulations, I think, eventually kills creativity. You have too many things that you have to juggle as a designer, as a creator, as an artist, as a builder, as an architect, and your town ends up as a museum. Something that happened in the past.
I think it depends on how sophisticated you are about.
Right, how you can get through it all.
But
right.
You wanted to add something. I'm sorry.
Well, regulations again don't drive design. It's driving what you're talking about in part. Wetlands and watercourse law. FEMA floodplain regulations, Bradley Meadows.
Well, here's
a floodplain.
Regulations are the zoning for, you know, how many acres per parcel. So if you take a 3 and 5 acre grid and superimpose it over natural topography, that's a regulation, and it controls the density, right? But it's an artificial regulation. It's a grid that has nothing to do with the natural topography and geography. It's just an artificial grid. Here we are. We can have 1.5 over here, 0.5 and 3 and 5. But what does that have to do with the organic web and flow of the topography and the geography? Nothing really. So that's a regulation that I think that has a major effect. I think the hamlet, one of the few opportunities for change, is to increase the density. It needs more pedestrians. It needs more people living in the towns with, you know, small apartments or affordable. I think obviously the parking issue is the big thing. There really isn't enough parking because it is a finite, small, over-censored village.
We didn't promise to be uncontroversial. So.
Amen. Okay, you should write your question down, Gay.
We
asked for folks to write down questions so we could just have questions, and we only have three, so anybody that wants to write one up quick, feel free. One that we have here is a comment, I guess.
that says, "I, for one, local, appreciate the informative schlocky sign." So,
who's
I second that, that emotion.
Is that your computer?
And the other question is, won't a historic preservation approach guard against more strip developments, such as Bank of America, Rite Aid, etc.?
You don't have to do historic preservation to do. I'm not advocating against it. We have something called certified local government in Kingston, and all of there are several communities in Ulster County, Stone Ridge, New Paltz, Saugerties, Hurley, which actually makes it a law, which you don't have here. But you can also, the zoning can also say, we don't want to see parking in the front anymore. Or we're going to base our, we're going to base planning regulations on form and form, the form of design and the location of design more than, let's say, the, and that's called form-based code. And we're recommending that in a lot of communities, but it doesn't have to restrict necessarily the design of new buildings outside, let's say, historic district. So.
Okay, we have a couple more here. How do we get more young people to join this discussion? You mean we're old up here?
We're both the youngest people here.
Well, that's why we got Sean here.
Oh yeah. My bad, part, I'm 29.
How do you want to join the discussion?
What young people? It's Woodstock.
Come on. Look at her.
Okay, there's not an answer for that? Is there a part of the discussion you want to raise here?
Someday the young are going to be taking over this community. And they're going to be the ones responsible for the new codes and laws. And they need to know where we came from. And what they can be doing next, and learning what we can from you guys and your suggestion.
Well, how old are the people on the Civic Design Commission?
We're old.
So maybe
very
you should old. Recruit
we have a range, right, Joan and Cornelia? But it's entertained. Every year, the town puts a notice out there. If you're interested in joining a board or commission, show up, make an application. I mean, I'm more than happy to step aside and have some 25-year-old take my position. I mean, that'd be great, but people don't participate.
I think it's a great question.
I have a question for the audience in relation to the town that we all live in. What is it that you're afraid of losing? I mean, that you would expect to happen in the town that might happen and that you want to protect? I mean, obviously that seems to be a big thing.
Coming off of that and your discussion of Airbnb, and back to her question, where do young people live in this town? Mm-hmm. What can they afford in this town?
Right.
And how can they be a part of this town if they can't even be here?
Taxes.
You got this conflict, and nothing against Airbnb and people who do it, don't say anything about that.
Right, now there's less places to rent.
Well, we grew up in this town, there was no problem finding an apartment.
Yeah, now we have cousins that can't find places to rent, my own cousins.
Right. So, you know, all those. A lot of those buildings, like next to the old, I mean, I've lived everywhere in this town, above most stores and things like that, and they were all available. Now they go for $500 a weekend, you know.
Right. So, to some extent, the conservatism that you talk about is something that, in a community that has more housing opportunities, let's say, like Kingston, is where younger people are going. So I think that's a question, that's a set of choices that also needs to be made, which, by the way, controversially was discussed in the comprehensive plan that wasn't adopted, which is how do you build affordability into a place like Woodstock by creating more housing choice. It's controversial, I know, but that's part of the problem. But, you know, I just wanted to mention, on our Landmarks Commission, I looked to add younger people, and I brought in a friend who's about 30, who's on the commission now, because I thought he would make a great addition. I think that's what has to happen. You need to figure out a way to engage younger people more directly, rather than you know, they have become disengaged. So how do you engage everyone in the process of governing? So they're governing themselves. It's not about us and them. I think that's something maybe the commissions could do.
I have a question here. A new residence inn is being built in Ulster. Would that design be allowed in Woodstock?
A new residence being built where?
Residence inn.
They wouldn't be
a hotel.
It shouldn't even be allowed in Ulster. No.
That's
what
Ulster
is.
Is that covers that?
Oh my God, it's the worst one so far. It makes the other two look really nice.
Yeah.
This one's interesting. We fear the Ulster County office building as modern architecture. Do we fear Frank Gehry? Define contextual.
Oh, that's good. Who asked that question? Where are you?
Marty.
Well, I think that Frank Gehry's design for the theater over at Bart is horrible. I think it's ugly. I think it's a fake. It's a sin. It's putting a false front onto a box.
Let me.
Well, that's what Victorian is too. I mean, that's what all. That's what arts and crafts. It's a box, and then you dress it up with stuff. It's the same concept, though.
I don't believe that building should represent what's inside,
glorified
the outside, what's going on inside.
Let me relate a little anecdote related to Bard. Before Frank Gehry got to Bard, Robert Venturi designed an addition to their library. And I was involved with Bard at that time, and kicking the issue around. The state historic, well, the existing library at Bard was this, you know, 1910 or so classical revival building with all its classical ornament shaped out of sheet metal. You know, pretty cheap and cheesy replica of a, you know, of a classical building. And so Gehry designed this addition to it, which, you know, by all superficial rights, had nothing to do with the building it was added to. So the State Historic Preservation Office got involved in it because Bard is in a historic district, big historic district there. And for some reason, they needed a sign-off from the state. They must have had state money in building the library. So, of course, the preservationists come in, and they see no correlation, no context for the design of this building. So the question was put to Venturi to explain the context of this building. And, of course, he did in his, idiosyncratic architect's way of relating, you know, how he was inspired to create this addition, and you know, it was meaningless to some people, but totally meaningful to him and perhaps his wife. So context is a relative thing, and compatibility is a relative thing, and it's all very much based in our own personal taste. It's something that's very difficult to define.
Well, some of these institutions like Bard and Balboa want signature architects. They want
They want
to do that. And Frank Gehry makes it very simple. My fee is 25% of the construction cost. Now most architects would never get away with that, but the president over there wanted him to do the building, no matter what. And sitting by itself, it was closer to the Hudson, and the neighbors complained, so they had to move it back because it was shining to everybody up and down the river. But Venturi, just an anecdote, Mies van der Rohe, who the Seagram building in the city and so forth, Chicago Lakeshore Towers, said, less is more. And Venturi said, less is a bore. Venturi was involved in pop culture back in the 60s and 70s. It developed that whole thing about making something out of something that it is normally not made out of and doing all that stuff.
Irony, we forget what that means.
Okay.
Thank you.
We didn't get to the.
We didn't get to the what's contextual.
To the county building.
Oh, the county building.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
We were just full of anecdotes.
Since I asked the question, the point that I was making is Bilboa and Bard are entirely separate mm-hmm. entities. One is in an urban environment, the other is in the park. So they're entirely different. You really can't compare the two. But Bilboa building has made that town, mm-hmm. has made it something specific. People are going there for that building. So how can we in Woodstock, how do we react to something like that, to great architecture in a town? If a fantastic architect came here and suggested something, what would this town do?
Well,
how would we react to it? And if someone lesser than Frank Gehry came to this town, how would we properly judge it as a town? And could we accept it? I tend to believe that we wouldn't.
We wouldn't.
Well, I know you
experience says.
You speak. You raise a whole, like, so many issues. One is the cult of the fame. You know, cult of fame with the Bilbao effect. You know that the building is now sought after in every community, as if that's going to create the destination. And a lot of universities look for that. They look for the signature building. As David said, if they have the money, they can make that statement. That's the point. It's like you're buying your signature.
You guys understand why Bilbao is so successful, right? I mean, the reason that Frank Gehry building in particular is the one that shines supreme out of all his buildings is because the city is homogenous.
Right.
Right? It's the perfect frame. And then there it is, this shining thing in the middle of it. So it has this incredible juxtaposition that makes it that more powerful of an attraction. But if you have, like at Bard and all these universities around the country now, they have a Frank Gehry, they got a Richard Meyer, they got, you know.
Let's bring it back to his point, which
what is
in a Woodstock context.
Right. Well, Woodstock context would be
like
a little small, you know, 1,200 square foot thing. That
it could happen. I think right? It could happen.
Just a little thing. Take it in there. Luggage, like a piece of luggage. Take it with you.
Part of could happen or not could happen has to do with how it's delivered.
Absolutely.
How it's put out there to
right.
The
well, you know what's great too about the Sanders project over here is what I was first attracted to. And by the way, when apparently the library board, when they interviewed 12 or however many architects, Joel Sanders didn't even present a building. There was no presentation of a building, and they retained him based on his presentation of his ideas.
Well, I don't think we want to get into this in too much
no.
detail.
No.
I'm so excited to speak because I am so I think I have an idea that's going to approach all the things you're talking about. First, I would say two things the town needs that are not about this issue are decent garbage cans and tree work. Because a lot of our trees are in trouble. And that affects the aesthetic of everyone. My solution is coming from my own heart of being a guerrilla artist. I've done like 5 different projects in town over the different years. And it makes me look at the town really differently. I look at every stone, every sign, every tree, every little thing. And one thing you could do that would make our town be back in the tradition of Maverick is to make the town a competition site for guerrilla art projects. In which people come to town and they find those small spaces and they work with them, and it's all temporary in the Christo tradition. My own little way. So my suggestion is that you open up the conversation because there is a really big world of street artists and guerrilla artists who would love to come to a small town with it's incredibly heterogeneous architecture, if you want to call it that nicely. Hodgepodge, you know, right? And to find little spots and do things. It could be everything from my own thoughts. I've always wanted to do a Potemkin village of Woodstock, done in the style of a Sotheby's style brick town. take some work and make sure the thunderstorms don't knock stuff down. To much smaller. And if the town was to make itself a center for that, where things are rolling over all the time, it's not the same as murals in Kingston. It's much more conceptual. But it also allows the town to never have to buy into anything. which is a key element. You don't have to agree. Anything's passing through, but it makes the town the center of things, whether it's like how to get from Mountain View Studios parking lot to town in a more aesthetic way,
right,
or whether it's how to get from the house parking lot up around by Golden Notebook, etc. All the little walkways. You know, you could designate areas as the center for projects, and then people do them, and then they come and go. And the town would be really fun.
Seriously,
I'm
not jumping
on the
Thank
you.
I like that idea.
Gary? Yes, thank you. I'd like you to try to read, and it's in the library, several copies of it, some of the results of the stone soup events that have taken place over the last 10 years. And the theory, the theme, that starts out in all of them is that we came to Woodstock for Woodstock, the farmland, the community spirit, the view, the look of it, the ambiance and things of that sort as it exists today. Mm-hmm. Now you can bring in all of the most famous architects and build up the most beautiful chrome buildings, and they don't fit here. We would not have the population explosion in Woodstock if we had that kind of, that more glitzy look to it as opposed to a hometown friendly atmosphere that people can come to and live in and have fun at. So I think that's something that should be considered.
Yeah, because that's too much for me. Some people have written a lot. Whoever wrote this can stand up and explain it to you.
Well, I
wrote
I'm getting a crap in my decorators. I think it was a very good cover story. Design, as we all know, is not something that
could you
is
speak
easy
a little louder?
Speak
louder.
I'm an architect, so the architects in the room that are designers, and we're artists, all of us. And we all know that good design doesn't happen just by wishing it. It takes people that are talented to do it, trying to have the ability to figure out what's appropriate in a design in a place that's. For instance, the library design we've all been studying that was presented by the Library of Extension. You know, its appropriateness, its size, everything on it, it's on the road, the creek. It's a very difficult design project. And that's not something that is easy to solve or to discuss. A good designer can solve a lot of problems, and often design becomes a design by committee, mm-hmm. which is one of the worst things that can happen. Yeah. So I think that Woodstock's the reason we're all here in Woodstock, from my point of view, is that it is like Jennifer's saying, we're all saying that it's the spirit of the place that is really hard to describe easily. Like anything that has a mystical, esoteric spirit to it, it is the thing that just happens, you know, that it's, we're in a great place. it's the landscape, everything about it, that's what it was, how it's become over time. Everything that I've experienced in my 50 years of being an architect that's designed in a short period of time usually is a failure. It was done too much, because it all just has a fixed look to it. And it doesn't have anything of the creative feeling that our town has that evolved over a long period of time. So you've got to really be careful at how you approach and make rules that doesn't give enough latitude for a designer. We live in a country that doesn't respect the design. Architects are looked at, by developers and people that wanted to build for make a lot of money. Are not going to be, never get never get the opportunities to really just do good design, and no matter what it is, the canopy on the roof is a good design solution for that building. But don't make a cliche, or we'll have a mess in our hands, you know. It's just, you know, each design problem is a unique kind of a thing. And we can't legislate design, but I've always wanted to legislate design in places. But how do you do it? Because, you know, it's very difficult. So it's it's just a bit, you know, it's a difficult problem. It happens, and it's an internal problem that is not easy to evolve in itself, other than just let people, as Sean was saying, take the restrictions away. Well, that's the way to let it happen. If you know that you're going to have people that are going to design something well, and that they care about the community, and that they're going to do a job that's for the community and not for their ego. So it's that's one of the things. Appropriate to me has always been the biggest, the most difficult thing in a design project, because I'm not an ego type of person. So finding an appropriate solution for a community, for a client, for whoever you're designing for, is to me the most satisfying and most important responsibility that we have as architects. Because we are trained in design, and we have a talent, hopefully, to really be able to understand it and come up with a work of art that is appropriate. Mm-hmm. So it's all little things that are all fit in are works that can be works of art, no matter what level they come out of. The car hasn't been mentioned. It was just a devastating thing. I come home every day and there's a line of cars that starts at one end and goes out the other. You know, and it's going to get worse. You know, the traffic light, we're always having to fight. The green is a big problem. And the other thing, I think, is just plain old, there's a lot of us that think of Woodstock as New York in the country. And that's what the diversity of New York is, something that we, it's a big thing, that we have a connection to the city.
Jay? Yeah, I'd like to make a couple of comments. I noticed that before we started, there was a roll of Woodstock architecture. And I was noticing that the front of Ann Leonard's shop was not up there.
It was there, Jay.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ann Leonard?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry I missed it. Yeah. Because
only 3 seconds.
Tell Jill she was the photographer. You must have missed something.
It's up again.
What is it?
The liquor store.
Yeah. Well, it used to be an art of visions. Those are not Ann Leonard.
Come
around. It's going to come around.
What was your second point?
In any event, another comment. I was glad that the result of the tea store across from Haust did not require small panes, many lights in the windows, which is something that the civic design likes to see. I'm glad that you didn't have to stick to that. And the other third thing I'd like to say is that the projection of two homes alongside of a contemporary home, it would be interesting to look at that from the opposite point of view. Consider that that's a neighborhood of contemporary homes, and two people wanted to build non-contemporary next to it. Think about what was going on there. There are a lot of other things, but that's basically what I was saying. Thank you.
I just wanted to respond to something Ken said.
Uh-huh.
You talked about design cliches, Ken.
And, you know, I think there is a difference between the ensemble that makes up, let's say, vernacular streets in a city like that neighborhood with the older houses. So, for example, when builders were finding solutions in the Victorian era, let's say, there's something that would, it was a mass fabrication of exuberance in design, right? Or in the 1920s, the Sears kit homes. You know, these were cliches, right? My house is a Queen Anne cliche. And that's fine. It's still lovely, but it's not exciting and new. It's definitely contextual. But then you think about, like, the old Dutch church and its moment, you know, rising up because it was this great civic institution that was built by a community and would not have been contextual with anything else around it. So I think it's all a matter of how you frame that, and do you allow for certain moments in the community to be the exuberant, or I don't even want to say exuberant because I use that for my Victorian cliche, but the special moment, the Bilbao, maybe even the county office building, which could have been better, but is actually, in my opinion, an interesting timepiece that sits at maybe a mistake to some, but it sits there as a moment. You know, 1964, IBM era.
The new
urban right. So it is what it is. I don't have a problem with the way some people do. But I agree that we wouldn't want to have too many chicken wings around Kingston as we destroyed our post office. Jack in the Box or CVS or whatever. So I think it's very important for us. What I was saying about this discussion, and this is why I wanted to respond to what you said, is that I think my goal in a community would to see the discourse go from here to here about these issues, so that at least we all become more literate in the questions of design. And I think I might say something controversial, if the library project provoked another discussion about what we mean by new design and whatever else it is, greatness in civic architecture, at least it did that, right? At least it got people talking about what they want, what they don't want, and maybe it moves the discussion forward a little. And that's my hope, is to see that discussion be open-hearted and intelligent rather than black and white, let's say.
On that note, we'll bring this discussion to a close and invite you all to have some refreshments.
Can I just make an announcement?